Missions Pulse. Know God's heart, join His mission.
You talked about privilege a second ago. I think we often talk about, you know, white privilege, economic privilege, some kind of privilege. Rarely do we talk about gospel privilege. And I think that's what we as Americans or Western nations have been for many years. We have access to the gospel at every turn, should we choose to locate that. In many people's contexts, there is no church, no Christian, no missionary, no access to the gospel whatsoever. And I'm just praying that, you know, we would lift up our eyes and see the great horizon that if we do not go to, it is so ripe that it's rotting on the branches, falling to the ground and being wasted.
Mm-hmm. And I, again, I think about some of the believers that I've had the privilege of interacting with in your region of the world in Southeast Asia, in comparison to not just, you know, the believers that I've met here in the United States, but at times I'll just say self-reflectively of myself that it's like, okay, you know, I punched the card, as it were, of I got to Sunday school, I got to worship service, you know, I've done the stuff for a week, and now I'm kind of done. Whereas
So ugly when you say it like that. It sounds so ugly, but when you say punch the card, man, it just gives me this weird visual. But I think so often that is the case, isn't it?
But it is. It's just like a timesheet. Yeah. And whereas about a year or more ago, when I was in Myanmar, and I was in a small town, and there were two Christian churches, and the local authorities wouldn't allow the two churches to meet together for fear that they would, you know, collaborate too much and maybe want to, you know, somehow have undue influence over the local authorities. And so I spent a little bit of time on one particular day with one congregation. And then on that Sunday there in the second congregation, they asked me if I would preach that morning. And so, of course, preaching through an interpreter to this congregation. And it was just such a passionate time of prayer and passionate time of worship on their part. And so I preached, and then we ate lunch together, and then the pastor turned to me and he said, "Are you ready to preach again?" And, you know, I'm like, "Well, you know, have Bible, will travel. I'm always ready to preach."
Good.
And so I said, "Well, absolutely." And he said, "Well, the people are staying for you to preach again." So I preached another sermon and got finished and sat down, and he said, "Well, okay." He said, "We'll take a little break." He said, "Will you be ready to preach again?" And so by the end of all of this, I had preached six sermons.
Wow.
And it, because they were just so hungry for work. And whereas I know, you know, at the time of us recording this, we're in between Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday.
Yes. Yeah.
And on Palm Sunday, my wife and I listened to five sermons on Palm Sunday from five different people here in the United States that are friends.
Just by pushing the button, right?
Just because I can.
Yeah.
Just because I can. And yet here were these people, including their pastor, who is just, you know, one of those people that I just hope that I get to sit next to nearby in heaven one day.
Yeah.
They're just so hungry for growth and for the word and for the fellowship of the saints.
Yeah.
And should we not all be that way, you know, all the time? And again, these kind of moments of great chaos and crisis in the world, if they highlight that in the life of the believer, that we know where the real hope is and we know where the answer is, then what's happening in the life of my neighbor?
Yes.
You know, what's happening in the life of my governmental official? You know, what's happening in the life of the guy who owns my company that maybe is not a believer? That I could answer the call and carry the hope of the gospel to that person.
And I like it that you bring it back to our zip code in our sphere of influence, because I think we don't want it to paint a picture of this missions thing that we're talking about in a far off, distant place. Really what we need to understand is that every member of the body of Christ is a minister that every one of us have value, that God created us for eternity, therefore to Matthew 28, make disciples wherever we go. In fact, I really like one other quote. I'm not sure if you or Ed Stetzer wrote this because you co-authored the book Compelled: Living the Mission of God. But it says this: we believe the church's purpose is to glorify God, not to make people happy. The church does not exist for believers or unbelievers. It exists for God's glory, for the equipping of the believers, and the church is God's missionary in the world. I think, you know, Spurgeon said you're either a missionary or an imposter. I think there is some lines to be drawn for those who cross cultures and go in the historical sense of being a missionary, but that missional zeal, that fervor for souls, I think is what we're talking about here. Have we been pressed into the heart of God long enough that it is emanating from us and therefore permeating our sphere of influence wherever we go?
Missions Pulse. Know God's heart, join His mission. This podcast is powered by Within Reach Global. Subscribe, watch, and listen on YouTube today. Visit missionspulse.com.